Hello everyone. It's another session of Excellence Talk. Together with Christian Forstner, we are welcoming another guest, this time from Belgium. Tom Meyers is osteopath. He's a body-centered stress coach, future-forward thought leader, and he is the author of Futurize Yourself, Design Your Life on Purpose. Hello, Tom. Welcome.
Hello, Murat. Hello, Christian, and thank you for having me on your Excellence Talks. I think we're going to have some inspiring conversations today that will help a lot of people during this period and during many periods, hopefully in the future as well. So I'm not going to say what we're talking about yet, but I'll leave that to you.
Well-being is always important in our life. It's also getting more and more important, especially in this period. Christian, what do you think?
I think we have a fantastic bridge now to excellence, since you might think that an osteopath like Tom has no connection to the excellence topic. How is that connected to our general topic, excellence, Murat? I think we have something. Look, as organizations strive to create more market share, more profit, trying to be excellence, whatever, specifically now in these difficult corona times, or since organizations are full of people, these people inside organizations, they feel the pain. They're stressed, they're overworked, they're overtired, and then add additional aspects in their family lives, in their private lives. So they need some help. And here is Tom, who has some fantastic ideas, recipes, and lots of experience how to help these people in these organizations and in their private lives. Tom, what's your topic?
Well, as you said it rightfully, osteopath, body center, stress coach, and thought leader are future, and especially the future of health and well-being in this fast-changing world. And not only from a body perspective, but also from a mind and spirit perspective, because, of course, human beings are body, mind, and spirit. It's a whole, and the person is also part of a community of society. And we are seeing today very much how our actions, our choices, sometimes not always consciously, are influencing far more than ourselves. For example, with the COVID-19 pandemic that we have, I don't think that some people in China woke up one day and said, I'm going to change the world today. At the same level, it's Black Lives Matter, that we have other cases, but George Floyd, for example, or that policeman, they didn't wake up in the morning and say, I'm going to change the world, but they did. There is already one lesson that we should learn and that I want to put out there straight away, that our actions of today have consequences that are not only for ourselves, for our families, but go beyond. And definitely in companies. And those consequences, those actions, decisions in a person that is stressed, for example, is of course very different than that same people is in his full potential, radiant, and in his or her well-being. So here we have to pay attention to the consequences of our health and well-being on ourselves and others, and also the well-being of the organization that we work for. An organization is people. There might be few people with more and more being automated or robotized, but it's still run by people.
And a big problem, Tom, I guess, is that most people, or organizations for that matter, are not aware of the situation that they need help. Is that true?
I believe that a lot of organizations, but also individuals, are or have forgotten the importance of health and well-being, having forgotten that everything we do has consequences, but also that there needs to be a balance by things that are automated and things that must be thought through and must be more voluntary or must be made by decisions and rational thinking, because we come from a society that has relied on others too much, or relied on technology or science was going to solve all our problems. When the computer came, or even when a dishwasher came, it was promoted as get a dishwasher, then you'll have more time to relax and to do the things you like to do. And what have we seen? It's not the case at all.
And if the
we started to work more, we started to be less connected with ourselves, and we've completely missed the ball that the body is made to do things spontaneously. If I walk over the street and a car comes, I need to jump. But for example, relaxation, or to eat, to drink, to give the nutrition our body needs, it doesn't come automatically. So you have this part automated and voluntary. And at the moment, that automation or that relying on it will pass, it will solve itself, it's too much. And I want to, if you permit me, Christian and Murat, I want to show you something with a prop that I have and that I use to explain things in my practice of what life is and what also resilience is, because this is what we're talking about. Yes, if you go too much into stress, then you reduce your resilience and also your adaptability. But also, if you're not resilient, then or go too much into stress or too much into relaxation, of course, your brain becomes weaker, your immunity becomes weaker, and that has consequences. So I want to show you this. This is what's called a Toro flux. And resilience is on body, mind, or spiritual level, is that when something happens, you rebound. Something happens, you rebound. You fall, you get up, you walk again. But what we are experiencing today, more often, is that the pressure, the resilience, you know, we are getting more and more, and suddenly, we are not really resilient anymore. It doesn't come out. And then things start to compensate and start to go. It could be physically pain starts, and then you say, it will get over. But many times you'll see 2 months later, nothing has happened. And it has affected not only our physical well-being, but also our mental state, our relationships, our work, and everything starts to be crumbling down. It could also be on a mind level that sometimes we have a shock, you know, something is that we thought we did a great job and suddenly we get battered by our boss or we get battered by our manager. And, you know, we really feel emotionally that we have been, you know, done wrong or that we don't get the credibility for us. And suddenly it's like a boom on our mind level or on our personality, on our values. And then suddenly things start to get stuck and we don't see the world as bright and wonderful anymore. And again, that will have an impact on the whole organization, but not only the organization, also the organization at home and our families. So we need to think more about, you know, keeping that kind of resilience that we go into the system, because resilience is also part of that kind of, we are flexible. This is what human beings are. 70 kilos and depressed is feeling very heavy. The same person, 70 kilos and light, hasn't changed anything of my weight. And so this is where I come in for some people, that of course to help find again this resilience into them, or what I call a reset, R-E-A-S-E-T, the return to ease, because ease is that level where people go into stress when needed and can rest and relax and recuperate when there is time for it or when there is no danger. And this balance is not only for themselves important, but it's as important in organizations as well, that people, when there's something happens like a COVID, that okay, something happens and now we have to see from how do we get out of it.
Tom, let me ask you, if people are in such a state, like the depressed state, the 70 kilos, I love this tool here, and they don't realize, and then maybe they don't know how to get out of this situation, mentally or physically, whatever that means, or health-wise. So who offers this wake-up call, or how would you call it, you know, for them to do something about their situation?
Well, in principle, you should hope that the environment, it could be a friend, it could be a family member that could point this out. But there is one element that it could be oil on the fire. That's why I often say to people before that happens is, who are your trusted people? and give them the authority to tell you when you're in a situation where they see you're not in your best place, that they, or a hand signal or a word that you told them, that they say it to you. So in that way, actually they said it to themselves.
It's a very powerful approach.
And that way you create a community that is self-supportive.
Yes.
Remember, this body, or all our bodies, are made of trillions of cells that work together. If something doesn't work very well in one part, the surrounding will help. And if that doesn't work, there is an immunity system that will come and help. Are we that much different? No. We are part, as individuals, part of a larger group. That's called holon. You are the individual, but you are the group. If you wait for others to do something for you, you're waiting for yourself. So somewhere we must have a bit more training in self-observation. And also we have to get these groups of trusted people where we can have feedback from.
Do you train people to better observe themselves, to get these signals, to understand, and maybe with the help of their environment to do something? And what can they do specifically?
In my practice, I do help people to be more aware of their body. And the best way to do that is to treat them when they come with a problem and with a demand. Mm-hmm. I want to get rid of my pain, or I want to be better at dealing with stress. Mm-hmm. But of course, they have an expectation. Beyond the expectation is also something that I think, or that from my professional experience, that I think I should partake with them, I should share with them, so they can, because there is the expectation, but they probably need more than what is expected, what they're not seeing. So I'm holding a mirror also. I try to meet the expectation, but more than the expectation itself. And also when they start feeling better within themselves, then they start also to say, oh, this is how I should feel. Around that, then you can start creating the tools to do the observation, or to help themselves to be more resilient through breathing exercises, for example, or to put very small parts into their life. I'm a big believer of small steps. Mm-hmm. 1 minute here and there, repetitive, rather than 20 minutes all at once. It's probably my own experience, my own personality, but in a busy world where people always say, I have no time, you have to start with the small elements to introduce that is possible. I cannot imagine that if I ask you to do something over the day for 5 minutes, that you are going to say, I have no time for that. Because then, even 15 minutes or 20 minutes or 30 minutes, your priorities are wrong.
Yeah.
The body is the vehicle for all your experiences, for all your dreams and realizations. If you have a dream, it's your body that will make that dream come true. So treat it well, because the treatment of your body, that health, will create the conditions of how you will experience your dreams or everything that you do in your life. And this is what people should start to remember, that the body is not something that comes with life. It is life. Everything you do, every good thing, bad thing, there is one thing that's always there, your body.
Very good insight. Personally, we can use it with the families. In the aspect of the organization, in the companies, what the companies, organization can learn from this to implement in the organizations?
Organizations, they need to think about what, as well as individuals, what do you really want? You want a thriving organization that withstands change, and change these days is one part, is a constant, and it's very fast. Then if that's your objective, who is going to do all of that work? It is your employees. If you are not taking care of your employees, of the demands that there is parts of, yes, we need to perform, but to perform well, you also need to counteract with health and well-being, with time to relax, recuperate, and regenerate. because recuperation and regeneration and healing is not done in a stress mode. If you sometimes you need to be on the ball, a company with who are in this situation anyway, has had a lot of stress onto them, but then you, who is going to solve the problems? Who is going to be imaginative and start to think out of the box to get out of it? It's not a computer, yeah? It's people. But if you don't give the brain, okay, for me, I see, if you think of the brain, three layers, the reptilian brain, limbic system, neocortex. Now, when you're in a stress mode, which part of your brain must be active? Well, it's the one that makes you survive, or yes. You know, and that's the central part of the brain. So where do you think the energy goes to?
Well, to that
it's part. Not going to go to the outside, where reflection, rational thinking, creativity. No, it's going to the center. So it takes it away. So what you're going to do in a time that you need to think out of the box or within the box, but to be creative into it, well, that's that outer layer of your brain. And if that doesn't get the energy through the blood flow, well, you're going to go back to old patterns and you're walking backwards, because that what got us here is not taking us out of here. No, for that you need to future thinking, and for future thinking you should not rely on old patterns. No, you need to create new scenarios. Any business has or should have a future plan, a 5-year, 10-year plan, different scenarios. Yes, and that's still within people that are going to create these scenarios, and it's still people that do these scenarios when they happen. But for that, you need to be switched on. To be switched on and not to go back into the past, you need parts of your brain active. So companies and you know, if you want to go into excellence, well, the body needs to have some time to relax, recuperate, and regenerate. You need to be able to think and be open and to give also the power to the people, because probably in your company, there are geniuses working in there with great solutions. And if they don't feel comfortable to share them with you, you lose.
So what I'm learning from your words now related to organizations, Tom, is obviously that leaders in organizations have a special responsibility, since they give directions, they make these scenarios, and they are the first to give advice when any disruption happens, right?
Yes. That's why I try to focus also on the leaders of this world. As I say, if there is one person I like to help, it's the leaders and the middle management. Because if I can help them to stay focused, to stay in their element, to stay grounded in times of change, and especially today, where the middle leaders are always the ones that get everything from the top and from the bottom. So if we can help them, then of course it will have an effect on the bottom and the top as well.
Yeah.
So, but also there need to be more awareness that them to function well, and for the organization, it is essential these days to have decent body work done, to work on the resilience, because everything is coming too fast, and this body is ancient. It's an ancient system on which the demands are getting bigger and bigger and the resources less and less. How do you balance that?
Yeah.
And so organizations must, for me, somewhere provide, if they want to run at the speed of change that is required today, then you need to give them ways to somewhere cope with that. And that is one, self-management, sure. But that's not enough anymore. We need a part, another part, that is accelerating that kind of alignment, that kind of deep reset, the deep stress management. I personally have a whole group of people around me that I can rely on, say, from, okay, now and then a massage, now and then a Bowen session with my colleague, now and then an osteopathy session, now and then maybe I need some coaching on a mental level. I have an acupuncturist. I have all these people around me so that I can stay centered and help the people further. Because if I'm not well, then I cannot give the service that I want to give. But for that, I have a whole array of people around me because I know that those people can help me in the balance. Yeah. And at the end of the day, it's a normal thing. We are not individuals. We are a society. We help each other. We all have potential and it's different. So my potential might be, you know, to help people in these change processes, but I'm not an accountant. So I go and see an accountant for help me. What would it be different on a health level that we start thinking about creating and help and getting help to help us? And many people see that as something that is negative. And I don't see that as a negative at all. I think it's something seriously necessary and essential for being in your excellence.
Let me pick up on this, Tom. If I think back about 20 years ago, some big disruption happened in my life, in my professional life, in a corporate environment. I felt treated in a very unfair way, and this pulled me down, and it was a crisis in my life. Fortunately, I had friends, as you said, a couple of minutes ago, and they shaped me, and so they gave me the wake-up call. And so at the end, I had used this disruption, which seemed to be very bad, as an opportunity and changed my life, also my professional life. Would you agree that we should try to use disruptions, whatever it is in our private lives, and they always happen, unexpected, as a chance, more as a chance, to redefine ourselves and to be stronger afterwards?
Yes. I'm going to give you a formula for that. But like your story, I had my story 20 years ago. You know, today I'm an osteopath, body-centered stress coach, speaker, and author. But 20 years ago, I was running a gourmet deli. I started it with very good intentions and with great help. It was like a friend who said for me, you know, why don't you start that? I will help you. He had a very successful business and I thought from, wow, you know, yes, thank you very much. I didn't know what to do and had this great opportunity. 2 months later, I was depressive. This was not, you know, this was a poisoned present from the universe somewhere, but it showed me that where I was, this kind of big disruption land,
yes.
This showed me that this is not me.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I had the local pharmacist who actually became a friend and she knew my story. I was 29 years old and I had never told my story to anyone. No one knew about my problems from my life. Only her, she had a bit of an inkling. And then she sent me to a coach. To say from Tom, you know, you need help, you need to go to a coach. Indeed, what you're saying, disruption land, these kind of moments, it shows us what? That probably we are not aligned with ourselves, that something is not right. I had the feeling from, if this is what life is, always this kind of moments where there is a great opportunity and suddenly a couple of months later, bam, I get knocked down. I had this so often. And I said, from this has, there is no point to it. There is no point to life. If this is what life is, there must be meaning, must be purpose. I must evolve in some ways. And let's say that luckily I've been able to get out of that. But one thing I needed first, I needed motivation. And my motivation was, how do I want to feel? I wrote that down 20 years ago from how I didn't want to feel and how I wanted to feel. And how I wanted to feel is, well, I want to feel healthy, I want to be in my elements, I want to feel that I'm meaningful in my life, that there is some purpose to it. Okay, so that became like a sort of objective. And how do you fill that in was, okay, what's my potential? In what can I be more of what I want to feel? So that the next level, because it's again different. I like speaking on stage, but I know that some people will hate that. So I like to talk, some people don't. I can teach people, but teaching students, for example, mathematics, that's not me at all. You know, I will not get out of bed. But to talk to you and to participate in this kind of in this conversation with you guys, this morning I woke up with, yeah, you know, I have this interview today. Yes, it's wonderful. So it gave me vibes. It gave me energy. So there is disruption land. If you feel not well, know that that is something we can learn from. In business, the same thing. If the things are not going well, what do you need to do? okay, this moment is monitoring what is not going right. So you have motivation is where you want to be. Monitoring is that moment where you feel from there is here something going on and I'm not feeling it. I feel like again going down the drain. Then you have a moment, an opportunity to watch on, okay, what's not going right? And then I have a goal that I'm working for. I have long-term goals. So I'm always referencing from, okay, I want to feel this way and I want to have this and that in my life. Is my current situation helping me to get there? Or have I deviated and am I again creating somebody else's dream, which was the case with the shop, with my gourmet shop. So that is then my monitoring that I can decide, okay, I've deviated from my path again. Okay, realign. And that realignment is then the negotiation or let's say the mediation. I can then decide, okay, what do I need to do to be back in alignment? Or, because be careful, some resistance is for growing. I'm still going to where I want to go. I'm still creating the experience to make my dream come true. And the dream is an ongoing journey. It's not a destination. Sometimes when I'm seeing from, oh, I'm still going to where I want to go, but you need resistance to grow. If I want to create muscles, I'm not going to sit in a chair, am I? I'm going maybe to go running or going to the gym.
Yeah.
What does that do? Well, it's, you have resistance in which you work and that feels uncomfortable. So growing and to be going towards your feelings or to want to be a better person, you need to be at the edge of a comfort zone. Don't stay in the comfort zone. So there is a big difference between the resistance that you have, disruption land. Is that for your growing or is that really showing you're deviated from your path? And the more that you're going to use this motivation, monitoring, and mediation, the more you're going to get to know yourself. Because I can say this today because I have 20 years of experience doing this, but I can assure you that the first steps were not so easy. And I still made mistakes and I didn't know the rationale behind it. But I'm hoping that whoever is watching this, that they can learn from my mistakes. And that I found there is a formula that I've been doing all this time and I've only recently found out about it. So 20 years later, I found out there is quite a simple formula. What's your motivation? What are you working for? What do you do? The things you do? How do you want to feel? Do you feel this way? No. Okay. Monitoring, mediation, do something about it. What can you do? Bring the things in that you know that you've maybe done already that give you that feeling. There is always been in your life moments of grace, of moments where you say, oh, I wish I could do this forever, or where you really felt from, wow, this is so great. Bring those in little by little, even if it's for 5 minutes, even if it's just saying, oh, I always like looking at a plant. Go and look at a plant just to have that little moment. And maybe that 5 minutes looking or being in your garden or really appreciating something that you're doing gives you a reload, you know, gives you the resources to cope with all the rest. But the vision, and that's when I come into what futurize yourself is. A business has a future plan. What's yours? What do you want? What do you want to feel? How, you know, what is that? What is that feeling? What's that optimum feeling? Now, then you have to go back to today because the future doesn't exist. Yeah. But you have big influence on your future. You know, all your choices today, all your decisions today, they create your future. So, but you have to know where you want to go. Yeah. If you put into TomTom, if you put into your navigator, you want to go to Paris, you have to put a destination in and then there is a journey to get there. It might not always be smooth, but then at the same time, you will find solutions to cope with that. What's your optimum kind of feeling that you want to create into your life? And you need that. You need somewhere to put that outside and then introduce it into your life today.
when I listen to you, I have so many deja vus and so many situations happen to me. And yeah, I go out and look at the little things, and this helps a lot. So it's incredibly helpful for our audience and us more than I to get your advice, all your experience. And these little examples make such a big difference. From my side, I have a last question, Tom. And right now we are still in the Corona times, which is a big disruption to on the big level corporations, but also on a very small, the family individual level. Would you go as far as stipulating that we all should try to make the best out of it? In other words, use this disruption, well, to think and maybe to reflect and improve things?
I believe so, yes. And I hope that people have been doing it over the last couple of months. Mm. It's been humanity's great pause, but technologies have at the same time exponentially grown. And this is the moment that we all should take and really start to reflect. And I think some people have had the click that to say from, okay, this can't go on like this. And there are some examples, for example, people that have been driving to work for an hour in the morning and an hour in the evening suddenly were at home and start to question from, is this really what I want to do for the rest of my life? This 2 hours in the car, and that is just, you know, 2 hours is probably an understatement, because most of the time the people that do these long routes or have these long routes, they probably are much more into traffic jams than anybody else. And also I've heard that some people can't cope. So they've been waking up at 5 o'clock in the morning before, and after a couple of months being working at home, they just can't do it anymore. Yes. So yes, this is a moment that we have to start thinking, yes, to how am I going to survive today? Yes, for some people, this is a big question, and they're not, everybody is in a very comfortable situation at the moment. And some people tell me, yes, but I can only think about today, not tomorrow. And I say from, okay, but you will survive today. But if then tomorrow fails, what's the point of today? Bring it into a plan of where you want to go to. Maybe not the public that this is what that is watching this, but for example, a taxi driver today, they have a very difficult moment, but in 5-10 years time, they will have a bigger problem because cars probably be automated and they lose their job. So are you going to wait till about 5 years time to do something about it? Or are you going to say, this is going to happen for sure. Yeah. What can I do when that happens, that I'm resilient to do something else, maybe to learn something? And then they say, yes, but I have no time for that. If then the crisis happens, what are you going to do then? What's the point? So people, please take the time to have that reflection from, how do you feel at right now? Is that really how you want to feel of the rest for your life? Because yes, how you feel today, and if you say that goes on and on and on over the years, if it's, you know, I feel stressed, you know, I wake up in the morning and life is, well, I don't want to get up really. My body is aching. Well, how do you think that's going to feel in 10 years time? It's not going to be better. Huh? It's going to get worse.
Of course.
Of course. So then you say, I'm waiting and waiting till I get, you know, for example, so many people that are doing things that they don't happy about and just want to retire. And then you think, but how will the condition be when you retire? For all those dreams you have that you want to do, do you really think your body will support you to do them at that age when you've neglected it for the rest of your life? Dream on, yeah? Dream on. It's today you can change things.
What a fantastic advice again. Murat, what a brilliant idea to invite Tom. What do you think?
Thank you very much, Tom. It was a precious information you share. Everyone have a link that they can have it in their life personally and also in the business. Your formula and your advices that we will use to be more resilient, get more stress-free, and we can have a motivation for the future. It was a great insight, Tom.
Okay, when people have questions, they can always contact me. Or the website is futurizeyourself.com. Very easy, because the importance that we have talked about today is to, what futurize yourself means is, today most of us living in conditions that are, you know, we have a roof over our head, we probably get food, we're probably in a very good condition compared to 50 or 100 years ago. The past Yes, was about survival today, tomorrow. We couldn't think too much ahead in time. But today, the evolution of our world, of technology, of our society, has created a condition that we can think about the future.
Yeah.
But it's not something that comes to us naturally. It's something you have to do, like eating and drinking. You have to start thinking long-term. It feels at the beginning a bit unnatural, but that long-term thinking, you say, where do I want to go? Bring it back to today. You say, okay, how can I make that happen? For some people that are going on holiday, what do you do? The holiday is in the future. How can I make that happen? I want to go to X. Then you come back to me. How do I make that happen? See life, your life, in the same way. And this is the biggest advice that I can give. So that is the future is that motivation. Come back to today, monitoring. Am I going there? Yes or no? What can I do to get there? Three simple steps that will make a difference. And it's not that complicated. The only thing that's in the way is you, because it is up to you to do that. Nobody does that for you. Thank you for having me, Christian and Murat. It's really, you know, I'm really privileged to be able to share some of my knowledge, wisdom, some of my experiences. I think it's very important. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Really appreciate that, Murat.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure for us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you again, Tom.